A joyful Christmas to everyone. Let me read first a couple of texts, one from Isaiah 9, 2 and 6, the other one from Luke 2, 10 to 14. Isaiah 9, verses 2 and 6. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. From Luke 2, verses 10 to 14. And the angel said to them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. Isaiah chapter 9 opens with a scene in the promised land of both gloom and rejoicing. It is set in 722 BC, when the northern kingdom of Israel was already taken captive by and scattered throughout the Assyrian Empire. The northernmost tribes of Zebulun and Naphtali were already exiled and therefore were already in gloom and anguish and were walking in darkness. What were the prospects for salvation of the people? How is God going to respond to their pleas for mercy? God says that those same people who walked in darkness have seen a great light, and the people and their harvest will be great, and they will rejoice. Why? Into all this darkness of sin, oppression, idolatry, and ignorance, God has given a son. The son has the fourfold titles of Divine Savior and Messiah, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. We will meditate on each of these titles this morning as we answer the question in the Christmas carol, What child is this? So first, this child is the Wonderful Counselor. The word wonderful describes God's wondrous, marvelous deeds in creation and in redemption of his people. What are these wonderful, marvelous deeds? Some examples are the dividing of the Red Sea and its safe crossing by the children of Israel, leading them through the wilderness by the pillar of cloud and fire, splitting the rocks of the desert to give them water, and the miraculous provision of manna and quails from heaven. Jesus also performed works that are called signs and wonders because they were wonderful. Healing the sick, casting out demons, raising the dead, feeding 5,000 people with 2 fish and 5 loaves, and calming the storm at the sea. Through the apostles, he continued performing these signs and wonders. The Hebrew word for counselor is one who gives counsel. God has wisdom, counsel, and understanding. The Lord is wonderful in counsel and excellent in wisdom. This son has no need for counsel because he is the wisdom of God. The promised Messiah will have wisdom, understanding, knowledge, and the fear of the Lord, Isaiah 11:2. The word for counselor also means helper or comforter. In Isaiah 40, verse 1, God promises people Israel that there will be a comforter to rescue them from exile because their sins have been forgiven. Jesus is that helper and comforter, and he continues to be our helper and comforter through another helper, the Holy Spirit. These two words, wonderful counselor, describes Jesus, from his youth to his adulthood. At age 12, he astonished learned Jews with his questions and their answers and understanding. When he taught, the crowds were astonished at his teaching and his authority. The Apostle Paul described Jesus as one in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So what child is this who was born in Bethlehem? He is the Wonderful Counselor. Second, this child is the Mighty God. This is unmistakable clarity. A child born of a human mother is Mighty God himself. How can this be? Because not only is he an ordinary child, but he is also the Son of the Most High. He is the Almighty God, most powerful than anyone or anything in the whole universe. In many places in the Old Testament, the Lord is called Mighty God. In Hebrew, the word mighty comes from a word translated as warrior. Therefore, God is a mighty warrior, as in Isaiah 42:13, where God is a mighty man, a man of war, who shows himself mighty against his foes. Since God is also the king of his people, he leads them in battle against their enemies. He led Israel during the time of Moses, Joshua, the judges, and the kings against their enemies. When Jesus first came, he did not come as a mighty warrior king. Instead, he arrived as a meek and humble child born in a lowly manger. He lived a life of suffering and persecution, leading to his shameful and accursed death on the cross. At that moment, Satan seemed to conquer him, but God's curse against the devil in Genesis 3:15 was actually fulfilled then. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. This is why Hebrews 2:14 says about the humble Jesus, through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil. Therefore, the Apostle Paul promises in Romans 16:20, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. When Jesus returns from heaven, as he promised, he will not come as a meek, humble man to suffer and die for our sins. Rather, he will return as a mighty conquering warrior on a white horse to crush unbelieving nations with the word of God and bring down the wrath of God on them, judging in righteousness. What child is this who was born in Bethlehem? He is the Wonderful Counselor and the Mighty Warrior God. Third, this child is the Everlasting Father. How can Jesus the Messiah be the Everlasting Father? But the title Everlasting Father given to the child born to us is not a Trinitarian title, since the doctrine of the Trinity was not yet developed in the Old Testament. Jesus is our Father in five ways. First, this name gives all Christians comfort and peace, because a father is a good provider and protector, giving love, compassion, and forgiveness of sins to all his people. Second, all believers are children of God. Jesus is our Father because we are children of God, and Jesus is eternal God. Third, because Jesus is God, he is eternal. He is the Son of God from eternity past to eternity future. Therefore, he is the Father of eternity, though he was born as an infant 700 years after Isaiah's prophecy. Fourth, because he is eternal God, he is our Father forever. Jesus can never cease to be our Father who provides and protects us, and we cannot ever cease to be his children at any moment in our lives. Fifth and last, Jesus says that He and God the Father are one. I and the Father are one. Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. Paul says in Colossians 1:19, in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Jesus is fully God as well as fully human. What child is this who was born in Bethlehem? He is the wonderful Counselor, mighty God, and everlasting Father. Lastly, this child is the Prince of Peace. The angel announced this to the shepherds. Though perfect peace will be the final state of the world after Jesus returns as King of Kings, the peace He brings to us today is between God and sinners. God and sinners are at war, but faith in Jesus alone will bring reconciliation and peace between a wrathful God and all repentant sinners. He is the Prince and King whose reign will bring about peace because He ordained peace on earth before the creation of the world. He will be the righteous judge between nations. When He returns and destroys all His enemies, no evil will remain. Therefore, there will be universal peace and no more war forever. Our text tells us that the increase of peace during His reign will never end. Isaiah 11, 6-9 describes this universal peace. Even the lion will dwell with the lamb, and little children will play with the cobra. God promises that in the new heaven and new earth, all children will be taught by the Lord, and they shall have great peace. Before He was arrested and crucified, Jesus encouraged His disciples, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you." Isaiah foretold that the Messiah would be pierced for our transgressions. Upon Him was the chastisement that brought us peace. Isaiah 53:5. When we consider the title Prince of Peace, think of the benediction by Aaron, ending in, "The Lord give you peace." Remember Paul's greeting to the saints, "Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ." Jesus gives us peace that surpasses all our understanding. Therefore, one of the gifts of the Spirit is peace. Dear friends, what child is this who was born in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago? His name is Jesus, for He will save His people from their sins. But He has four other names in Isaiah 9:6. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. All praise, glory, honor, and thanksgiving be to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.